Located in Dallas's Forest Hills neighborhood, on the original homestead of Dallas' first surveyor and founder, Warren Angus Ferris created this cemetery upon the death of his first son in 1847. It is the mission of the Friends of the Warren Ferris Cemetery to restore the landscape to the standards of a wildlife habitat and blackland prairie as a means of honoring those buried here.
So Michael, walk me through what has gone into the restoration plan. Are there several unique habitats existing on this one site?
Well, there are. We've got obviously mixed woodland, which is what we're standing in right now.
Yeah.
Then down there in the sunnier area, there's a blackland prairie habitat.
What have been some of the challenges encountered during the first year of this project?
Well, the first challenge was just the overwhelming amount of invasive plant species.
Oh yeah, I bet.
When this project first started, the first time I saw it, except for a few little narrow mowed paths in here, it was head high in privet.
Mm.
But as soon as that stuff was removed, all the native stuff that was here began to rebound.
Back, yeah.
Probably one of the most spectacular examples of that is the Engelmann daisy,
yeah,
which is down here in the uh-huh. in the blackland prairie. That was here, but suppressed
yeah.
by shade. And as soon as the privet was gone, it exploded.
Yeah,
it
just liberated.
It was gorgeous. Yeah, it was gorgeous. And that was, that was a major hurdle. And I have to give huge credit to the volunteers because they have done unbelievable amount of work. And it is very difficult. Then it was really kind of idea of deciding what we wanted to do here and how to make that work with the site.
Mm-hmm.
And the Texas Society of Surveyors, the local chapter, donated a topographic and tree survey. So that's how many of the paths got worked out. That's where we knew where the sloping areas were that we needed to deal with.
So speaking of other organizations, I hear the SMU Archaeological Study is also involved.
It was. That was very, very early on, actually, before the beginning of the current effort.
Yeah.
Back in the late 80s. That's when the site was slated for development. And people in the neighborhood said, wait a second, there's an old cemetery there. So the SMU Archaeological Department came out and did an archaeological investigation. So in terms of doing a landscape design, that means no major grading, no hardscape,
yeah.
No paved walks or anything like that. So we have to be really careful about not disturbing those lower strata so that we preserve any archaeological.
Preserve the graves.
Yeah.
What other partnership organizations have made this restoration successful? I imagine it has to be a team effort.
Well, it is a big team effort. Texas Conservation Alliance, which is one of the oldest conservation organizations in Texas, recently gave us a gift of some native plants.
Great.
To restore stuff, and they had some volunteers out here. To raise kind of awareness of the cemetery and the program, it was on the White Rock East Garden Tour this year. And despite the fact that it was raining that day, we had a really good turnout. A lot of people were really curious about it. And Texas Discovery Gardens has given a lot of support, both in terms of expertise and also donations of plants.
Mm-hmm.
So we've had a lot of help from many people.
So for people that are curious and interested in this site, is there any good way for them to get involved?
Well, sure. They can visit the Friends of Warren Ferris Cemetery website, which announces all the upcoming events. There's a monthly volunteer day, first Saturday of every month.
Great.
And that's essential in a project like this, because you don't work on this and then get it finished.
Mm-hmm.
It's never finished.
Always a work in progress.
It's always a work in progress.
For those people that are interested in embarking on their own habitat restoration journey, what kind of things can they expect?
Well, the first thing you need to do is find out what you have.
Yeah.
And that's obviously the plants that you already have, but also the soils, sun and shade conditions, because those all affect the type of habitat that you can develop. Because you want to work with your existing conditions.
Yeah. I'm sure the first step is stopping mowing and letting
grow. And stopping the use of all synthetic chemicals.
Yeah.
You definitely do not want to, it's like a Lucretia Borgia garden, where you invite everybody in and then you poison them.
Yeah.
Bad. bad plan. Yeah. So you stop that stuff.
So is it helpful for people to maybe go out and walk and visit some local preserves to see what's growing in their area?
Absolutely. And if you're working on your own project, obviously what you're trying to do is find things that are similar to your site.
Mm-hmm.
It's really helpful to go with somebody who understands this stuff, because it's overwhelming at first, and it's hard to see the forest for the trees,
yeah,
so to speak. So if you can go on guided nature walks with
an expert.
Yeah, with an expert, you know, and somebody from the Native Plant Society, a master naturalist, somebody from the Audubon Society.
Mm-hmm. The Nature Conservancy.
Nature Conservancy. Every several months they do a program at Keimer Meadow.
Yeah.
Which you can go out,
yeah,
to see. So all of those are great resources.
Let's explore some of the plants that have emerged this summer in the cemetery. Has anything really interesting come up?
Well, there are a lot of interesting things. This, of course, is one of the stars.
Oh, wow.
This is green milkweed. And this is a host plant for monarch butterflies. And it's highly valued because, as we know, monarch butterflies are in trouble.
Yes.
And populations are crashing, and this is a very important food plant for them. And the flowers also provide nectar for them.
Great.
So it's got two just.
Great.
And this is a seed pod.
Wow.
Which is about to open.
It's so alien looking.
It is.
So this is the plant that feeds the caterpillars?
Yes. Oh. Yes. And the adults with nectar when,
yeah,
the flowers.
Wonderful. So it also looks like there's a lot of great grasses still surviving.
These are little blue stem, which are one of the big four prairie grasses,
yes,
in Texas. These were here.
Oh, wow.
This area was not covered with privet. And so these were here before we started work.
That's wonderful.
Which is great. We've also added some Indian grass. It's immature at this point, this,
mm-hmm,
wider bladed stuff,
mm-hmm,
which is... It produces a lot of seed in the fall, as does the little blue stem, which is really important for migrating birds.
Yeah, great bird seed.
Yeah.
Is that some standing cypress I see?
Yes, right there.
What great color.
Yeah, it's great. That is a perfect hummingbird plant.
Oh, I bet.
They love that. It's like a guarantee almost.
Mm-hmm. I know one of the goals out here is increasing wildlife habitat. What kind of features have you guys added here to make it more wildlife friendly?
Well, you know, for wildlife habitat, you need food.
Food.
The plants provide that.
Yes.
Okay.
Lots
you
of
need
seed.
Shelter.
Mm-hmm.
And we have a lot of natural shelter here with shrub thickets and the evergreen trees.
Yeah.
But we've also added a number of other features. Like you can see a bat house up there.
Oh, great.
And with the mosquitoes that are bothering us today, I really wish there were more bats here right,
yes,
now, because they're great for mosquito control. We also put up several bird houses. The one that I'm most excited about is the owl house, because barred owls are common in this,
yeah,
part of Dallas, and,
yeah,
they would be a really spectacular addition. Last thing you really need to add is a permanent water supply.
Yeah. So it's the food, the shelter, and the water access. And that's the trio to create a wildlife,
exactly,
habitat.
Exactly.
Fantastic.
When I'm watching my own garden,
yeah,
I mostly see monarchs in the spring, like March through May. And then I see another, perhaps heavier concentration of them in the fall. So is that typical?
Yes, for sure. So, you know, habitats like this, like the Blackland Prairie, are in the critical north-south migratory pathway for monarchs as they're making their annual journey to, mm-hmm, their breeding grounds in Central America. So you'll see a flux of them in the spring and then a return of them in the fall as they make their journey back. So it's great and very, very important to provide flowering habitat like this,
mm-hmm,
to be nectar sources for the adult butterflies, but also to have the host plants like the milkweeds that we've looked at today, because those are the only plants that monarchs will lay their eggs on for their caterpillars. The caterpillars must feed on those milkweed plants to become toxic as adults.
And that's why they have those bright colors.
Those bright coloration, yes,
yeah,
warning signs of their toxicity to,
exactly,
their animal predators.
Exactly.
Well, Michael, thank you so much for meeting with me today. You're so knowledgeable, and I've really enjoyed learning more about this project.
Well, thank you. And this is the kind of thing I just love. I,
yeah,
enjoy doing this.
Yeah. Get outside.
It is estimated that there are roughly 50,000 cemeteries in Texas. 16,000 of these are mapped as Texas historic sites. Based on feedback from county historical commissions, about one-third of these have no caretakers responsible for their upkeep. Together, we can make a tangible impact to protect important natural areas and endangered species habitats. Let's connect the dots to revitalize local wildlife and build migratory highways for monarch butterflies and birds for thousands of miles. Let's put you on the map.